Your anatomy book is probably 300 pages long. From all the anatomy covered in those pages, learning how to identify the bones of the lower limb feels like a breeze. However, learning how to pronounce them can be a daunting task. So watch this video to learn the list of bones of the lower limb that students find the most difficult to pronounce. To make things a bit more interesting, we'll provide you with a short overview of the most important facts related to these bones. By the end of this video, you'll be able to master pronunciation of some of the trickiest anatomical terms for the bones of the lower limb. The first bone on our list is the ischium, or ischium, one of the three bones that compose the hip bone, with the other two being the ilium and the pubis. These three bones develop independently during fetal growth. However, during puberty, they fuse and comprise a complex and compact hip bone. The ischium in particular is an L-shaped bone that composes the posteroinferior part of the hip bone. It consists of the body and the ramus. The body fuses with the ilium and pubis and forms a socket-shaped surface called the acetabulum, via which the hip bone articulates with the femur and forms the hip joint. The ramus, on the other hand, joins the pubic bone to enclose the obturator foramen. Next on our list, we will cover three with similar pronunciation: cyamella, fibella, and patella. Even though they might sound like the names of three Italian sisters, they refer to structures that we find in the knee. What they do have in common is that they all are sesamoid bones within the knee region. Patella, or the kneecap, is the most famous one. It is embedded within the quadriceps femoris tendon, sitting in front of the knee joint and protecting it from injuries. Cyamella and fibella are less known. However, you might end up being asked to name the sesamoid bones of the leg, so here's how to do that properly while being all-inclusive. Patella, cyamella, fibella. The cyamella is a sesamoid bone, usually embedded within the popliteus tendon, while the fibella usually sit within the tendon of the lateral head of the gastrocnemius muscle. Now, this can come across as a true pronunciation conundrum. As you know, a phalanx is a long bone consisting of the base, shaft, and head, found in the skeletal core of each finger and toe. However, if you want to refer to these bones in plural, you'll say phalanges. So put simply, phalanx is singular and phalanges is plural. The phalanges are found in the hand and in the foot, being distributed into the proximal, middle, and distal rows. In the foot, the proximal phalanges are located distal to the metatarsal bones with which they articulate via the metatarsophalangeal joints. The phalanges also articulate with each other, proximal with middle and middle with distal, via the interphalangeal joints. Every toe but the thumb has all three sets of phalanges. However, the thumb is missing the middle phalanx and contains only the proximal and distal. Let's move on to the calcaneus bone, also known as the heel bone. The calcaneus is the largest and the most proximal bone of the foot, sitting below the talus bone. It belongs to a group of tarsal bones which bear the weight of the body more than any other group of the foot bones. The calcaneus connects with the talus, which lies above, and the navicular bone, which lies in front, via the talocalcaneal and talocalcaneonavicular joints. The posterior surface of the calcaneus provides the attachment site for the Achilles tendon, therefore being the main site of pull for the plantar flexion of the foot. Moving on to the next item on our list, the cuneiform bones. The cuneiform bones are the three tarsal bones found in the medial side of the foot. They are divided into the medial, intermediate, and lateral cuneiform bones. The set of cuneiform bones lies between the navicular bones proximally and metatarsal bones 1 to 3 distally. Being on the medial side of the tarsus, the cuneiform bones contribute to shaping the transverse arch of the foot, which makes them very important for the unhindered gait cycle. And that's it! We've covered the five most difficult to pronounce bones in the lower limb. Hopefully this video will give you more confidence when talking about any of these structures.
Knowing how to pronounce these terms is one of the many things you need to do when learning human anatomy. So you're not done yet. Continue learning with our fun videos, interactive quizzes, detailed articles, and stunning atlas connected to these terms. Click on the button to find everything you need to become a master in human anatomy.